So I am Layana Aguilar.
Hello, my name is Guido Hartray.
Like, why does this matter?
Hi, I'm Lucia. I'm a 16-year-old drama major at LaGuardia High School.
Stop and look at the garbage.
That's a good question. I don't really know the answer.
We've done a lot on a local level, you know, even before I was in politics. One of the things I cared about was building more community gardens, especially in areas where people don't have access to open space. And so we decided to build two community gardens in Niger properties. And we created the first green residential committee in all of Manhattan for a Niger residency. And so the reason why it's so important is just not having beautiful spaces in your backyard, but teaching the importance of, like, why does this matter and how you can get involved and actually get your hands dirty and you can actually contribute to making this place a better place, whether it's on a local level or if you look at it kind of like in a higher level, that if we can do this everywhere, it's going to have a great impact in, you know, reducing greenhouse emissions, making the air much cleaner, and teaching people that you can be connected to the soil and the dirt. And then, you know, we've always gone to the marches, whether it's like on Earth Day or any climate kind of like justice rally, to make sure that, you know, people hear this and it gets amplified. And some of the first white papers that I've done have been centered around sanitation and waste, because this is an issue that's going to affect me and every generation.
I try to just do whatever I can, like composting and recycling, and try not to buy too much plastic. And I also try to fight for change on a broader level, like being in protest yesterday. I sang a song at a rally that was fighting to preserve 1,000 trees that the city wants to cut down in a park near my house.
You try to push around the edges and make, unfortunately, really mostly make incremental progress. So for example, today I was on a call about a project that we're starting, and we were talking about the mechanical system, and some systems are more expensive, they cost more up front, but they can be more efficient, and some systems cost less up front but are inexpensive to install. So you try to kind of work with the client. They have a budget, so there's a limit to how far you're going to be able to push them, but ideally trying to push them to pick the most efficient system that they can afford, to kind of recognize both, you know, maybe a system is going to cost a little bit more upfront, but it's going to save money over time, or maybe there's some other benefits to that system.
Even when I was younger, I was always very resourceful. We didn't have that much money to buy clothes, so me and my sister loved changing my clothes, and I realized, wow, I was actually doing that since I was a kid, and now I can actually do it in a bigger platform.
I started bringing reusable plastic bags with me everywhere I go, just to like stop taking the paper bags, and like I try to shop for clothing more sustainably, like buying secondhand and thrifting and stuff. I don't know.
I feel like we saw it a little bit during the pandemic, how people became a little more conscious because you were home, you were not going out as much, and you realized, oh, maybe I don't need to always be wearing something different every time, and kind of like recreating your wardrobe. I feel like we need to realize that less is more. Many times when you become so aware of how impactful and hurtful the consumption that we have in New York City and in the country is, you realize, oh my God, I don't want all this stuff. And I'm a designer, I live off selling clothes, but I'm telling you, you don't have to buy my dresses every 6 months, because all goes into waste, all goes to landfill, polluting rivers, the air, and what are we gonna leave for the next generation? We have to think less is more.
We need to create some mechanisms that make it in people's self-interest to adopt higher performing lifestyles, lower carbon impact lifestyles, it's not going to be in self-interest in and of itself. The New York City government passed some legislation to fine buildings if they're inefficient or if they use more than a certain amount of carbon. And basically the way they've set it up is that starting now, buildings that are in the bottom 25th percentile of energy performance in buildings are going to get fined. And then like 15 years or something like that, it will actually be the bottom 75%, which will get fined. So that means that actually most buildings will have to pay fines or improve their energy performance. So that's something that the city has done. And so when, you know, when you're having a discussion with a developer about a building, now that's in the back of their mind. You know, yes, I could opt for the less expensive system today, but that might mean that I'd be getting fined tomorrow.
Two ways. Right now, everything's on the consumer. You must recycle. You must do this. I think we have to start keeping businesses accountable. And if they're not following, you know, the right practices to make their company much greener, I believe they should be fined, right? And when we look at whether it's like a big oil company or even a small business, like they can reduce a lot of waste if they're given the right incentives to do so. And I think we won't be able to change the mindset unless the people that create the products we buy have that mindset changed.
The problem is that too many people have a mindset that just my actions aren't gonna do anything. And that's true. You know, one person by themselves can't change anything. But if everyone thinks like that, then nothing's gonna change. And you know, the world isn't just gonna fix itself. We have to actually take action and try to do something.
Also, we have to just start with education on an early basis, right? The importance of less meat consumption, the importance of recycling, the importance of composting, and expanding that network to every neighborhood, would just teach people that if you don't have to put a plastic bottle in a plastic bag, to put it in a plastic garbage bag to dump it outside, right? And so I think we have to keep businesses accountable. Then we have to start with early education on the importance of the climate.
Earth Day means, you know, I am buying more time for my children and the next generation.
Because I've literally never done anything for Earth Day. Usually I forget about it, and I'm like, oh, yesterday was Earth Day.
Okay, then you can say that.
Really? Honestly, I have never really celebrated Earth Day.
I think it means to me kind of like acknowledgement or recognition of who we are, right? I think as individuals, we put ourselves in such high importance, but I think Earth Day makes you reconnect with kind of like that you live in this bigger world. You live with billions of people around the globe. And, you know, and we should, the same way we treat our mom, we should treat our parents, right? We come from this earth and we should treat them with respect and care for it. And know that the same way you treat your brothers and sisters is how we should treat everyone else on this planet. And so I just don't think about it on kind of like an environmental way, but just how more on a human rights way and how we like treat each other is how we're going to treat this planet.
To me, Earth Day is a day where people actually acknowledge climate change, because a lot of people don't do this year round.
I've never really thought that much about Earth Day.
We have similar experiences on this matter.
To me, it's sort of strange to have a day when we think about the Earth. That's kind of bizarre. So I think it's, you know, I guess we need to have an Earth Day, and I think it's probably good to think about how we will observe it and what we can do on it, and it's better than nothing. But for me, an individual date to observe something is not so significant. I think it's what's significant is what you can do every day, from day to day, week to week.
COVID is kind of a point of reckoning. I've been able to go camping and leave my phone at home and just to kind of distance myself from technology. Now we spend every day on Zoom, so it's just so necessary to be able to see something else.
We have a, there's a upcoming project that you may have heard of, the East Side Coastal Resiliency Project. And that project is intended to protect the city from the impact of sea level rise. But the strategy in our neighborhood that the city has adopted to do that is to bury our neighborhood park under 8 feet of fill. So that's something that is, it's quite upsetting to think that we might lose that that park for the period of time of construction and then the period of time that it takes, you know, vegetation to kind of grow back and trees to grow back. But it's, you know, it's actually not going to affect us indirectly as much as a lot of other people who are more sensitive to it. So I think, you know, for us, it's relatively minor impact. Really an impact is not being able to kind of maintain your livelihood because your farming no longer works in the area that you farmed because the climate has changed, or, you know, more significant things like that, or impacts from storms, impacts from droughts, fires, things like that. You know, I think particularly in the Northeast, in a city like New York, you're relatively insulated from a lot of the direct impacts. Which may be a bad thing because it might not have us take it as seriously as we should.
Living in New York City, you see the garbage outside every day, right? Here, that's one of the downfalls of living in New York. And if you take a look, really like pay attention to how they say, like, stop and smell the roses, stop and look at the garbage, and you'll be very aware of how much waste we produce here in New York City.
Drastically. I mean, the biggest example was Hurricane Sandy, where, you know, the poorest part of our district were flooded, but also the richest part of our district were flooded. And I think it really showed that no matter who you are, you're affected by climate change. And it cost the city not only billions of dollars, but it also really created trauma to a lot of people. And we still see it today where a lot of the repairs haven't been taken care of. And it just shows that we're lacking behind.
Lately, I've been very interested in dealing with waste in better ways. And both individually to have a very small bag of trash that you throw out once a week. Feels good. And then I, you know, also that's something that in buildings to make it easier for people to separate waste, make it easier for the people that are getting the waste and recycling from people's, you know, from a trash room out to be collected and so on, like making those things work better can make the people who have that job be able to kind of think about it in terms of elevating the kind of performance as opposed to just kind of struggling through.
Yeah, so this is pretty much half of our policy platform, whether it's increasing like composting to every neighborhood. And I think that's where that education comes in. It's like if kids start seeing their parents composting, they're gonna start composting. That's going to have a generational effect. But one of the biggest emission greenhouse gas emission happens from vehicles. And so by stopping vehicle traffic in certain streets and making them completely open, it's going to make us less reliant on, you know, owning a car or using a car to get, you know, within the neighborhood. And, you know, increasing protected bike lanes, connected bike lanes, having busways just like the 14th Street busway, on Chamber Street, on Houston Street, would definitely reduce our reliance on cars. shift us to a much healthier, greener city. One of the biggest land use decisions we want to do is in FIDI. There's this plan that England created that says make way for Lower Manhattan, and it makes much of FIDI all pedestrian. So we won't have car traffic, we won't have garbage, and I think that's going to be the model that we can implement in the rest of this district.
Ever since having my brand 8 years ago, I did a little bit my part by not buying as much, making my own clothes, but I honestly did not think about the environment as much as I think now. The fashion industry is such like damage to the world and to the environment. And I'm so small, and at first I was thinking, what can I do to change? I'm just, you know, one little emerging designer in New York. But I said, you know what, little by little, we can change. I have my own clothing label in New York City, and I also own a fashion school for kids, also in New York City, where we love to teach the next generation of fashion designer the importance of sustainability and upcycling. I'm making sure that I use my social media, my platform, to show people how, listen, I'm not, even though I'm a designer, I have access to the latest fashion. I'm not always just buying, I'm upcycling my clothes. I take it from my grandma's closet, my mom's closet, all of my kids' clothes, I've upcycled them. 90% of our wardrobe is all either upcycled, thrift, or things that I make.
My friend and I are doing a cleanup by the bay and the Rockaways, and we're hoping to make it a recurring thing, like once or twice a month at least. And yeah, hopefully the cleanup is gonna bring more wildlife in and more people in as well, because it's like a beautiful place and a lot of the community doesn't know about it or just thinks of it as trashy. So hopefully more people will come and like realize that New York has a lot to offer.
Well, actually, I started celebrating Earth Day by making a point of this week. I'm only gonna wear sustainable clothes. So either things from friends that I know are sustainable. For example, these pants are from my friend Natalia J. Mag. And this jacket I made, this top I made from one of my husband's t-shirts. So I'm gonna only wear sustainable clothes today, which I already try to do most of the time, and just like showing my kids, we're watching like Earth videos and educating ourselves and amplifying my message more and more every day.
This year I'm going to be, it's not going to be on Earth Day, but I'm going to be planting trees in Staten Island, and I'm going to maybe go for a nice walk with my dog. Appreciate nature.
We're definitely going to be joining the march and any activities that happen is on the street. No worries. How are we going to celebrate Earth Day? So we're going to join the rallies, the marches, but we also want to address a lot. We want to make sure people focus on the issues in our community and what they can do. And so we'll not only be doing like social media posts, but when we're out there, we want to tell people why this race is important when it comes to the environment. And so we're going to have a really busy day.
It can't just be Earth Day that we're giving back to the environment. It has to be every day.